Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board-certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Stephen Baldwin is our guest tonight. Stephen is on Celebrity Mole, which is coming up this Wednesday.
I believe that's at 9 o'clock, 8 o'clock. Kathy Griffin was in here last week, and I'm trying to remember what time that was. 10 o'clock? Holy crap. ABC Wednesday night, like I said. And Kathy was in here, Kathy Griffin, that is, crying the blues about you putting a sleeper hold on her during the filming of The Mole.
But, well, obviously it didn't work.
No, she seems to be going strong, yeah.
And like a little extra energy.
Well, let me say this, that I was over doing some test shows with Jimmy on the new ABC show, and Kathy Griffin was going to be one of the guests for the test show. So Jimmy said, "Now I heard on your radio Kathy crying about Stephen throttling her.
Yeah.
So we got to see if we can get that tape." And I said, "All right, well, let's see what tape we can get." And the tape is Stephen's giving her sort of a neck massage and then sort of jokingly gives her the hands around the neck.
Was that it?
And we were looking at each other saying, that can't be what she's talking about. There must be more." But then we never saw it.
Did you see it?
No.
You saw the one thing you're talking about now?
Yes.
Okay, now let's see. I have to go to Drew. Because now, Drew, let's say, in your professional opinion,
yes,
I do something to someone that this young man observed and said, "Hey,
right,
what's the big deal?"
We were talking about this last night. It's called a cognitive distortion. Where somebody perceives entirely differently than the reality, especially when it's on tape.
Well, you do.
So
women,
that was really it. We can't believe it.
Well, here's. Listen, Kathy Griffin is a funny lady. She's a talented gal, and you know, I'll tell you what is my perception here, which is, you know, obviously she has some misdirected frustration. Because, you know, she's funny, and I'm funny, and I make movies. So,
you're in trouble.
No. See, I would be frustrated, too, if I were just funny.
And not making movies.
You know what I mean? Thank you.
Right. She's Thursday nights at the Laugh Factory.
Yeah, so, but I mean, you're in trouble as far as she's concerned.
What happens is, I'm really, you know, just doing the mole thing. I'm like playing the game. I'm there to win.
Yeah.
Blah 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 blah. and I'll tell you something that I probably the next part of that equation, that or more of that story that probably hasn't been told, because what happened was, I did that, and you saw it. It was like ridiculous. It was no big deal. It was clowning around. Whatever.
It was clowning around, but then somebody suggested, well, maybe there's more to this.
Maybe they cut out something. No, they didn't cut out anything. But what happened was, see, we're guys.
True.
So that's automatically, that's psychologically very different.
Yes.
Is that true, Drew?
Here.
Yeah. So what happened was, we're playing the game, and at one point while the cameras were rolling, you know, it's like if you're talking to somebody over there, and even though the cameras are rolling, I may say to Drew, "Hey, Drew, you better watch your roll."
Right? Right.
Okay. Well, we're playing a game.
Right.
So at some point, she starts to, like, you know, she starts throwing, you know, darts, and then they go to daggers. And I'm the youngest of six that got my ass kicked my whole life.
And you got some, your brothers are beefy guys, too.
Yeah, you know, I used to take, like, you know, I used to tape four M80s together because they always said it was like a quarter of a stick of dynamite.
Right, right.
You know, I'd tape four together, light it, throw it in Big Al's bedroom.
Yeah.
While he was taking a nap.
Yeah.
That's how I grew up.
Yeah.
So if you want to go there, I'll go there.
That's what happened.
So she decides
she went
to
there.
Like, well, it was, and it was weird
you got
because
there.
Cause she, it, what happened was the cameras were over there.
Yeah.
But, like, we were in the background,
yeah.
And she's, like, you know, throwing darts, and I'm kind of laughing, like, you know, you're in way over your head. And at one point she says to me, and like, you know, she starts like, you know, yakking right. and like you can just see the toxins coming out of her pores.
Yeah.
You know, and I look at her and I go, I said to her literally, I whispered so that the camera wouldn't pick it up. And I said to her, look, I said, you should be careful right now. And she goes, yang, yang, yang. And I was like, you know, you obviously didn't read your contract. And there's an addendum because my lawyers like reviewed the contract about mm-hmm. what's liability this and da da da. And one of the biggest kicks I got out of the contract was the production is indemnified from any participant doing anything to another participant. So you sign a waiver that says if I die, you can't sue. And right. you sign a waiver that says if Dr. Drew punches me in the face right now. Hey, that's the game. So,
Sound like Stone Stanley, the producers of LoveLine and the Man Show.
But wait a second. Here's what's so funny. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's one of those silly, willy, you know, repercussions, you know, one of those things, those protection things they do. That's never going to happen. But I look at Kathy and I say, you should be careful right now. And she goes, what do you mean? I say, obviously, you didn't read your contracts. And she goes, and she, like, you see, she starts to twitch.
Mm-hmm.
And I just feed right into it. You know what I mean?
And is that's so then she took the playful strangling as a big deal?
This was after that. This was after.
Right.
This was later. This was later.
So then I said, you didn't read your contract. And she goes, what's that supposed to mean? And I said, well, that means that you don't realize I could punch you in the face right now and there's nothing that anyone could do about it.
Right.
But I was kidding.
Yeah.
We're playing a game. It's a psych out game.
I think Kathy has a little momentum with men and probably had some issues.
What does that
issues.
Mean?
I don't know if we've talked about it on the air before or not with
Let's
Kathy.
Let's talk about it.
Well, it's unfair with her not here.
Yeah, and I don't know exactly, but I would say
you're always Switzerland.
There's no female comedian who did not suffer at the hands of a man at some point in one form or another.
That's not true.
And
it's
They all have. That's where they got their sense of humor.
That's true.
But well, regardless. Don't dish out what you can't take.
I'll agree with that. And also, keep in mind, it's a game, and people are trying to win. And is it $250,000 you could have won? I guess it says winner.
Perhaps I did.
Winner could take home $250,000.
Correct.
Crazy.
Is that that's the amount?
Yes, sir.
Oh, no wonder Drew had a cow when the radio. Our program director told him he couldn't go do it during the fall book or whatever the hell we're doing that. That's
you
why
invited?
You're spazzing out.
Dude, you'd have won.
Oh, no. Now I'm...
Yeah, he's pure pussy. He wouldn't have won, but...
You'd have won.
$250,000?
Isn't that crazy?
So check it out. So 4 hours later, I'm at another location, and one of the producers like pulls up in his personal vehicle and pulls me aside. Someone you know...
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And says, hey, can I talk to you a minute? And, like, pulls me aside. And it, like, reminded me, like, when I got fired from several movies. Huh. You know, like, when they pull you aside and they go, this is the toughest part of my job. You know? And he says, hey, you know, did something happen? And blah, blah, blah. Because, like, Kathy's wigging and she was crying and she wants to go home. And I just was like, what a wimp.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I know. It's the mole, too. I mean, it's all part of the game.
Well, you know what it is? It's like, hey, in my opinion... You play with fire,
you're
going to get strangled.
Yeah. All right, so that was all. All I saw is all that was.
I'm glad you brought it up you did.
I'm glad I saw it, because it was a massage.
And we men got to stick together.
But it was not a throttling.
But then did things settle down after that, or did she keep going?
No, I genuinely felt bad if, in fact, it had
you
caused
her.
Some reaction psychologically. But,
right.
You know. But be careful. And then, see, now here's the thing that's so silly. Then she goes out and in interviews and in the media starts being an idiot again. And, you know, and the bottom line is I could tear her a new a-hole if I wanted to. But I'm not going to do that because.
Too much class. You got too much class, Steven.
Exactly.
It's a class
I understand.
Act. This kid's a class act.
I understand.
He could tear her a new a-hole, but
nope.
Too much effing class.
Too much effing class.
But listen
kid.
To me. I understand her frustration.
Yeah. I think she wants you. I think that's you know what I miss, by the way, is a guy I was talking about this in the office the other day.
Yes.
I miss when you could say when a chick was a pain in the ass or a little uptight, you could turn to one of your buddies and go, "She needs a good effing." That I miss that. I miss that society.
Now, did you see the first episode?
No, I didn't.
She comes up to me on the first day of the gig, runs up to me, like in the opening shots of the creation of this production. She goes, Baldwin, call me in my hotel tonight. I have to talk to you tonight. I'm under this name. I'm in this room, which is kind of like almost against the rules. So like either she's doing some mole thing, you know, or it's like doing some distractatory kind of whatever intellectual miss something. I don't know. And I'm like, okay, I never call her. So you watch the show that aired last week, and she goes, "So I told Baldwin to call me on the first day in my room, and he never called me, and I think it was because he thought I wanted to have sex with him."
I just wanted to get some dick.
You know, and it's like,
all right, let's not. I can't bash her anymore. She's a dear friend.
Not fair.
Yeah, yeah. All right, but celebrity mole.
We can call her though.
You got her cell phone?
Yeah, I saw her. I was watching the American.
Is she
Music
a dear
Awards,
friend? Did there. You see her whoring on the red carpet for like publicity?
No, I just saw the end part of the AMAs. But yeah, I've known her for about 15 years. But good person, dear friend. But
hey, what's this
I'll
button here that says
issues.
Pig?
Chris,
I like that button.
You're 20. What's up?
Yeah, I my girlfriend. Every time I go to finger her, she has pain.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know if that was normal or
is she
so every time you you set about to undergo the fingering process, there's pain involved.
Yeah, she said she feels something every once in a while, but then she just feels pain.
Is she a virgin?
Yes.
Okay. Well, maybe that's the hymen you're pushing up against.
You got a high school ring?
No.
How old is she? Oh, for God's sake.
She's 20.
20?
20. Virgin, huh? That's pretty good.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
Or maybe she just has a little sort of vaginismus, some spasm of those muscles down there because she's kind of tight. Maybe the virginity is because of some reason.
But how, I mean, a lot of guys, young guys, fingering technique. Well, first off, they put the word bang right in there, which is probably a bad.
Yeah, what is it called? Finger pow.
Well, I'm just saying finger bang sounds.
You know what I mean?
Sounds like.
Did he just say
a little
that?
Raucous. No, but I mean
that's usually most of our callers.
They do hear the finger banging, and the technique is more subtle than the banging technique. But Chris,
yeah,
Steve, get focused.
You have to.
Love line.
How's your technique? Is it rhythmic? Slow? Is it gentle?
Slow and gentle.
All right.
Either she has some spasm of the muscles.
Is your girlfriend Kathy Griffin?
Or she is...
I said virgin.
...has a hymen there, and you're sort of pushing up against something that hurts. That's all. It's all right.
At 20, should you have your hymen?
You shouldn't, but you can.
Could he find her hymen?
Of course you could.
Yes, you could. That's my point. You shouldn't, but you could.
Well, could you find it? Could he find it?
Yeah.
You would feel it?
Yeah, possibly.
What would it be like?
Like if somebody pushes up against it, hurts.
It's like when you take the cap off a new thing of multivitamins, and it's still got that little cardboard...
There you go.
Membrane there that you got to shove
like
your
that.
Thumb through.
Yeah, kind of like that.
Yeah.
A little bit different.
All right there, Chris.
Good time.
All right. Let's talk
Did
to
we him. Give him any advice?
I don't think we gave him any advice.
No, he didn't answer advice. He just wondered, is what is it? Is it okay? Yes, it's okay. It's one of two things, and that's that.
Just leave it alone.
Yes. She doesn't. She either way, she's not sort of ready for this, it seems like.
Tammy?
Hello.
You're 28?
Yes. This is kind of, I'm not sure exactly how to ask this. I'm wondering if there's anything a woman can do to develop a sexual desire. Because my husband and I, we've been together for 10 years, and there's no problems in the relationship. It's just we've buried all of our children. We have genetic problems.
Oh, my God. How many children?
Four.
Why did you keep having kids? Did you know?
We didn't find out until the second one, but there's only a 1 in 4 chance with each child.
And you had it all four times?
Yes.
You got a 25% chance
per
of
child.
Having this genetic problem with each child, and you had four kids, and all four of them had it.
What was the gene? What's the disorder?
It's non-ketotic hyperglycinemia. It's NKH for short. Their brains produce too much glycine.
Huh.
Glycine's neural inhibitor. So,
were they born dead?
No,
it's an inborn error of metabolism, neurodegenerative disease.
How long do they survive?
Our first son was 20 days. Our second son was 8 days. Our daughter was 3 days. And the other one, we found out it was sick before it was born, so we took care of it.
Yeah. Wow.
Wow.
But, I mean,
yeah, but good times, right? I mean.
So have you had any depressions or emotional reactions to this?
Oh, yeah.
Well, are you being treated for that?
Not currently. They've put me on Paxil before, and that didn't work for me.
Well, that will shut down your libido, though, so.
Okay, well, I haven't been on that in a couple of years. I don't have health insurance, so.
You think about adoption or something like that?
We had a private adoption lined up at one point, but the girl changed her mind at the last minute, so.
Nice.
And that's, you know, they need to do what's right for them, but I was just wondering if there's anything I can do.
Yes, there is. After 4 pregnancies, Tammy, it's common for women to experience a sort of biological change after 1 pregnancy even, but 4 especially. And doing something as simple as getting on the birth control pill sometimes can restore some of that normal biology and the libido with it.
I've been on the pill since 99.
Which pill?
Elise.
All right, Elise. That may be the wrong one. You know, you have to experiment around to try to find one with the right dose of estrogen versus progesterone, because different women are affected differently by these various chemicals. Some women are charged up by progesterone, some women are shut down by it, and you've got to find what works for you. But it probably is that by it's obviously the psychological situation, but it sounds like that's sort of in hand.
But let me ask this: if you have a 1 in 4 chance of this genetic defect occurring, you've had 4 kids, all 4 of them have had it. Don't we got to bump it up from 1 in 4 at a certain point? Doesn't it go up to 50-50?
At some point, you have to wonder whether the way the gene is penetrating is the way they're predicting.
In other words,
there may be something about the way this gene is passing in this couple that's different from what usually happens.
Right, because...
100% now.
Yeah, which also, though, means if you have a 5th kid, it's impossible they have anything because they use it all up.
Yeah. You would hope. Doesn't really work.
That's the way I look at it when I gamble on football each week.
I understand.
Could possibly lose 9 games in a row. I've already lost 8. It's a mathematical impossible. Oh, the Jets lose. Wait a minute. How does this happen? It's impossible I lose every goddamn week. How can I lose every week? You think you have pain, Tammy. I've got real pain over here.
All right, but Tammy, there are biological things that can be done. So there's changing the pills, experimenting with that. Attending to your mental health, make sure your affect is good. And if you do have a mood problem, don't get on one of the serotonin reuptake inhibiting drugs that can make the libido problems worse. Think in terms of Cerazone, Wellbutrin, or Remeron. Those are antidepressants that don't suppress sex drive.
Oh, we buried 4. Oh, the buried part.
Yeah, nice. I thought that with that disorder, the kids lived a little longer, too, which is in a way worse.
Yeah. It's worse to bury your kid after a year than after 8 days.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oof. I mean, isn't it?
Oh.
Ball?
Oh, please, God. Please, God, give Adam a child soon.
What's the worst year to bury your kid?
Oh, shut up.
Well, I just mean...
Oh, my God.
No, here's what I'm saying. 8 days better than 8 years.
8 days under 3 months is about better than anything, I'd say.
Yeah.
After that, you're screwed. From then on.
Emotionally.
From then on.
Yeah, but still 6 months better than 3 years.
No.
Really?
Yeah. I went through the thing at 11 months.
Drew's, who was it, George, Douglas?
Yeah, had surgery 11 months.
Had a brain, had something going on in his brain. 11 months? Man, I'm glad I didn't know you then, by the way.
Oh.
Yeah, it would have really brought me down.
Now he's fine?
Yeah. Great.
Praise God.
Genius. Genius, this kid. So,
like young Frankenstein, they just removed the brain
and
put in an Adam Carolla.
Yeah, they put in my
brain. Now he's a genius.
Yeah, except for I got no brain. All right, let's take a break here.
Whoa.
Huh?
Yeah, all right.
Well.
Yeah, good times.
It's 10:20.
Yeah.
That's about time. Right. Stephen Baldwin's our guest tonight.
Hello.
He's on Celebrity Mole. Wednesday nights, ABC, 10 o'clock. That's coming up.
Why
this
do you guys
Wednesday?
Do such a short clap thing now?
We used to be longer.
Yeah.
Well, it's for you.
Do you have a longer clap for
that was good.
Stephen Baldwin?
You picked up on that, Drew.
There you go.
Thank you.
Wait a minute.
We'll be back.
Hello. Is this LoveLine?
Call 1-800-LOVE-191. Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back.
Hi, this is Alec Baldwin, and you're listening to LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Hey. Stephen Baldwin is our guest tonight. Stephen is going to be on Celebrity Mole this Wednesday at ABC at 10 o'clock. And your brother, Alec Baldwin, who I'd never met before, I ran into at JFK Airport about 6 or 8 months ago. I had a nice chat with him. He's a very friendly guy and came on to the show a couple weeks later. Did he not, Drew?
Yeah.
That was nice of him.
I'm just thinking I judged Miss USA with Billy.
Well, hey, can I get a copy of when Alec did it? Because I'd really love to hear it.
Can you? Yep, Ann can do it.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Yeah, he was good, as I recall.
He crapped in the bed.
That was him.
That was Alec Baldwin? Really?
He also said something about Ojai. Remember that?
Yeah, let's hear that one.
Do you own a ranch in Ojai?
Now, do all the Baldwins get together? Do you guys have? You guys hang out much? You play golf? Do you have reunions? Does everyone head back to New Jersey and all that stuff? I mean,
you from Jersey? Sometimes, yeah. We were just all here on Sunday, and we were going to watch the Jets. But then, you know what it is? It's the same kind of sibling dynamic. You know, it's like if Drew were the youngest, that was anyway.
It was for him.
Yeah, I mean, let's say we were your ass like a hacky sack your whole life.
Totally,
right?
Totally.
It just keeps going.
It was the Brady Bunch on crack.
Doesn't stop because of 35.
No, it stops, but Steven's pissed.
Maybe some anger issues?
Oh.
No, but here's my point. Like, let's say we were brothers, right? Yeah. And you guys were older than me.
Yeah.
So, like, we were planning something. And you guys say, well, this is the plan. And then I go, great. And then, like, 5 minutes later, you go, well, forget that.
Yeah.
That, you know, isn't that always the dynamic with brothers?
Yeah.
So they here's the thing.
That's cognitive distortion again.
I call Billy.
Go ahead.
I can't say anything now. Drew hit me with one of his 50 cent philosophies.
But here's the question.
But no, wait a second. Yes. I don't live out here. Alec and Billy come out here all the time. I hardly ever come
out
here.
Where do you live now?
I live in Nyack, New York, up on the Hudson River.
Seriously?
And, I'm like getting out of this business. But anyway.
Really?
Yeah.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to write and direct movies.
But you can do it from home. I mean, you come out and do a project and go back home.
Well, it's the only way I can be happy and be in love with my wife.
You're up by Ossining and Sleepy Hollow and all that stuff?
No, sicky. What are you talking about?
Where the city is here?
I'm by the Tappan Zee Bridge. I'm 30 minutes north of Manhattan. All of that stuff is way further north.
Oh, further north. All right,
Drew. I want to finish him. I want to finish.
So I call Billy and I go, "Hey, I'm coming to L.A. It'll be like around Sunday.
Right.
Let's go to Oakland and catch the Jets."
Right.
So Billy says, "No, because Alec's going to be here, and I'm having a huge Jets party at my house."
Right.
And I go, "Great." So like. A day goes by, and I'm, like, changing my flight, and da-da-da-blah, da-da-da-la-la. And I call Billy, and I go, "Hey, man, you know, what can I bring to the party?" He's like, "Oh, no. Alec and I got to go over here and do this, and now we won't be able to get to my house until, like, the second half." You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, they just...
It keeps going.
They just keep peeing on the little guy.
Yeah.
Now, is Billy... I haven't seen him popping up too often lately, although I've not gone out and seen every movie that's been released. Is he doing a lot of work? Is he acting? Is he behind the scenes more?
Well, his wife's got talent.
Yeah.
Who's his wife?
China Phillips from Wilson Phillips. So I guess, you know, she can bring home some of the bacon.
Yeah, is he working? Is he trying to work?
He's done a couple of films that are coming out. And he just signed a very interesting television possibility.
Hmm.
So he's got to do a pilot and all of that. And, you know, he's a little bit... I'm the psycho of the bunch. I like work because I just love it.
Right.
Billy kind of kicks back and...
Yeah. Yeah, it always seemed like a voluntary thing. Like, he could work more if he wanted to, but he's a little saner than everyone else and has money and likes to relax.
Right.
All right. Unlike Alec, who's a workaholic... As well, or at least maybe he doesn't want to do Crank Yankers, because every time I call, I was like, "Yeah, I'm playing 8 roles in Cat in the Hat, and then I'm doing this indie thing, and then we're shooting this thing on high def, and then I'm producing and writing." And
good night.
Yeah, seems like a pretty busy guy, Alec. Levi,
Yeah.
You're 19?
Yep.
What's up?
Well, me and my girlfriend have been together for like a little over a year. And normally she was really open to anal sex. Like, she was totally a freak, and I totally loved it. I was totally into it. But then recently, within like the last 3 months, she's totally shut me down every time I've tried to pursue any sort of inclination towards that at all.
Mm-hmm. How does she shut you down?
She just I don't know. She gives me the cold shoulder. Like, if we're having sex and we're totally in the mood or whatever, right in the moment, and then I try and pursue anything towards that, whether a push, a prod, whatever, and then she just stops cold.
No.
Mm-hmm.
And she won't even finish anything. Like, she won't even, if I say, okay, I'm sorry, she totally won't even,
Yeah. Levi, you do ever with a guy?
He's gay.
True, please.
What?
Are you bisexual?
Well, I played around a little when I was younger, but I tried to kind of calm down with that and settle down.
Right, just have anal sex with chicks and pretend they're dudes?
Sure, maybe once in a while, but no, I'm trying, I like
her. All right, hold on. Turn the radio down, please. Please. He sounded gay to us.
Yes, immediately.
I don't want to stereotype here, but everyone sounds like something angry. People sound angry, and people that got molested sound like they were molested.
A little bit of that, too, by the way.
A little molestation?
Yeah.
Well, let's see. Levi?
What?
I'm sorry to disturb you at home, jackass, but you called the show and you had your goddamn radio up, so I told you to turn it down, just like the screener told you to do.
No, I turned it down.
All right.
Thank you. Okay.
Sorry for that outburst. Now, listen.
Faggot better
Drew,
run. No,
please.
What is that?
Please. Was there any molestation when you were younger?
No, not that I remember. I asked my parents about that. If anything happened before I could remember, and they both said no, so not that I know of.
Did they look at each other, give a long pause, your mom kicked your dad in the shin real hard, and then they both looked down and said no?
No, I asked them separately, actually.
And why would you ask? And by the way, I got to ask my parents.
What made you ask, yeah?
Well, I don't know, because some of my friends had, been into, had situations within their family, and actually my cousin had a situation with her stepdad, and so I don't know, the situation arose in our family, and so I just asked.
All right, but you don't consider yourself bi at this stage in your life?
No.
All right.
Okay.
All right, so and she shuts down completely in the middle of the act when you sort of move things towards the rear?
Yes.
All right.
All right, why don't you not do that anymore?
Yeah, don't do that. She's not into it anymore.
For whatever reason, we'd have to talk to her to find out why. Maybe she's got a problem. Maybe there's something mechanical going on.
Tell her to call in.
Be that as it may, she doesn't like it. She ought to be able to tell you why not, but just stop going that direction.
So do you think it would be worth it to stick it through and, just not pursue that anymore? Because I really enjoy it.
Right, but do you think you could be satisfied without it?
Yeah, but it adds a little spice to our sex life.
All right, well, it hurts her.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is she used to be into it.
She's going to have to figure out what it is and tell you eventually, so she gives you an explanation. And don't ask when you're in the middle of a sex act. Ask, the time when it's
a
tender moment.
What if she just put a beard on and gave you a BJ? Would that be a reasonable compromise?
Probably not.
Okay. All right. Like she put, one of those Carl Sagan turtlenecks on and a big, thick beard and maybe a monocle. No women wear monocles, do they? There's no monocle humor anymore.
No.
People wear monocles. They'd be surprised and fall out and land in their martini glass.
It meant surprise.
Right, never.
Right. It meant surprised.
Monocle meant surprised, right?
It meant a rich person
was shocked. We gotta start.
When you direct
doing
your film,
movies,
there you go.
We need monocle humor.
Listen, we need to give him a list of
Yeah, what's that hotel lady's name in New York, that mean lady?
Yeah, Drew, please, come on.
Oh, for God's sake. Something Palace.
Yeah, she did time.
Yeah!
The Something Palace.
She's got monocle potential.
Yeah, she does. Leona Helmsley.
Leona Helmsley. We ought to do a thing, some kind of spoof with, a Leona Helmsley and a monocle Lewinsky.
Well, Write that down. It's going to be the first one. Women don't have monocle potential, but they have opera glass, not opera glasses, but sort
glasses
of the, reading glasses on a stick that they pull out.
But what's the name of those? I mean, you can't know monocle and not know what those are.
Glasses on a stick. And what are those called?
Reading glasses.
They're not opera glasses.
Reading glasses.
Reading glasses?
Yeah, they're old ladies.
Well, monocle is for surprise, and glasses on a stick is for examination.
Can you pull it up on the web or something?
Yeah.
Who cares?
Yeah,
we're coming up with film cinematic conventions.
Monica Lewinsky.
All right, here we go.
I would like to figure out the name of the glasses on a stick too.
You just like saying stick.
There's something about the opera that has to do with
stick.
Those things.
Christy, 18.
Dick.
Christy, you're 18.
Uh-huh. There are opera glasses, which are the ones the binoculars on
Christy.
A stick.
Christy,
I know. Yes. Oh, those are binoculars.
What are those
on
glasses
a
on a stick called?
I don't know. Glasses on a stick.
But they're also glasses on a stick. They read with little ones.
I know.
All right, Christy, what's going on?
Oh, okay. My boyfriend, who I love dearly, is like fast all the time.
How fast?
2, 3, 4 minutes, maybe.
Mm. Did I just delete something?
Mm-hmm. No. We're fine.
2, 3, 4 minutes.
And you want to slow him down, right?
Yeah, I want to know if there's like anything I can do or he can do to make it last longer. Mm. Because while I'm pretty sure, you know, he gets his, which is great and fine, but, you know, there's another person involved here.
How about oral sex? Does he do that with you?
Yeah.
Do you like that?
A little bit. Not. I'd rather have sex.
Do you have orgasms pretty easily?
No.
Have you ever had an orgasm?
Once.
How'd that happen?
He was drunk.
And he kept going. How long did it go that time?
Maybe 30 minutes.
Ooh.
Wow.
Wow.
So,
just keep getting him drunk. I mean, that's the solution.
So it's, the orgasm is looming out there in the distance, but it's like some buoy you're trying to swim to that's like 5 miles offshore. I mean, who's up for that every night? That's the worst possible scenario. Let me just say this, because I've had this happen a few times. I would rather a woman not be able to orgasm at all than have the buoy 5 miles offshore, because that's like every day you get in the surf, you put your foot in the water, it's like, oh, it's cold. Oh, Jesus.
Get going.
You get up to your waist, your balls hurt, you're like, I got to go all the way. I don't see the buoy. I'd rather not see the buoy. Do you know what I'm saying? I'd rather it not be there than have it be way offshore.
Drew?
That's a cruel joke. Do you know what I'm saying?
What can this young man do
to sustain himself?
Besides shooting heroin.
There are, one of the things people don't think of often is they can put a condom on. Sometimes that decreases
sensation. No, that's not going to work.
And it doesn't work that well, but some guys it does.
Masturbate
a lot more frequently. Sometimes that sort of prolongs.
Yeah, you know what you ought to do?
What?
You ought to let him have an orgasm
and then go
once
there you go.
First.
Yeah.
And then wait like 10 or 15 minutes and then do your thing and see how long he goes and then kind of play around with that ideology there.
In other words, sometimes maybe he'll need two times before you.
Right.
Can, yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Once he's done, he's ready to go to sleep.
Well, then you got to go like this. Yo, homeboy, check it out. If you don't do this program, you're out.
Right. It's not going to happen the first time if you don't do it the second time.
Okay.
All right. And also, I'm wondering.
Women do not understand. They have all the goods. They have all the power. All you got to do is use it.
I'm wondering if they did something during the afternoon or something, and the guy took a nap for 45 minutes or something, if he'd be
Don't implement the Corolla technology
there. I like the nap on things.
Mechanisms.
Yeah.
All right. I usually wake up good to go, though. Hey, Christy.
Let me do my own sound effect now. Ready?
I've been gassy lately. It's funny. Always funny.
Take another break.
I take a break?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Stephen Baldwin is here tonight. Going to be on Celebrity Mole Wednesday night, 10 o'clock. ABC, we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Hello, this is your radio. LoveLine will be right back.
We'll be right back.
everybody. It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Stephen Baldwin is our guest tonight. Stephen is on Celebrity Mole.
That was better.
Celebrity Mole, ABC, Wednesday nights.
It's a psychological
10 o'clock.
Thing. It's a psychological thing.
Let's get back to the phones and speak to Sarah, who's... Let me just say something real quick. We're talking off the air about the hotels and what's good and what's bad and the W Hotel and how much it sucks. And a lot of people listening to the show probably never stayed there. It's a little hip, a little cool. But let me say this about that.
And then I said how great the Le Parc Hotel was over there on West Knoll, yes. Over by the Beverly Center.
Le Parc Hotel. It's good.
It's a great hotel.
It's good to punish those who deserve to be punished. And the W Hotel is one of those places. Jimmy and I have stayed there many times. We hate it. Everyone we know hates it. And I don't know how these places stay afloat. I'm guessing it's the Emperor's New Clothes. But here's the thing. Anyone who's listening to me, don't stay at the W. It's way too much. It's crappy, and it's too cool for its own good. And listen, stop supporting crappy things. Everybody. You know these shishi restaurants that have a ton of attitude, and they act like they're doing you a favor for serving you a $35 entree? F them. Stop going, everybody. Stop waiting in line. Stop going to all these cool places. I want the cool people punished. And we can do it. We can just not go.
You know what I mean? You know what's great?
What?
You haven't changed a bit.
I'm keeping it real, Stephen.
Damn it.
I've not met a person that is secure who doesn't like the W Hotel.
No, but describe the people who work at the W Hotel again. That was my favorite.
They look like they work on the Concorde. They mock turtlenecks, headsets, and way too cool for school. Guys with big squared off black shoes with a heel on it.
Accents.
And bad mock accents and the inability to kiss ass, which is number one on my list of hotel employee attributes. I need some ass kissing.
Well, anybody that's around you needs to be able to do that, wouldn't you say?
Yes!
Yeah. Stephen, make note.
No, but you're spending $575 a night. I want a little ass kissing. I don't want some bisexual guy who's fresh off his acting class shooting toot at me. I don't like any place where the person who works there is cooler than the people that are going there. Yeah. I can't stand that.
Wait a second. In his rage right now, where did bisexual come from?
Because that's what these guys are with the mock turtles.
Do you ever get to analyze him?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know these guys.
You're not going there.
No. Okay, no. Are you kidding?
Oh, wait a minute.
You're great.
Five. Sarah?
Hello.
You're 14?
Yes.
What's up?
Nothing much.
What's up, Sarah?
Okay, let's see. When I was about 9, I tried acid for the first time.
Hold on a second.
Yes.
How did you get your hands on it at age 9? What motivated you at 9? What?
My parents. My mom is real heavy into drugs.
They suggested you take it?
Hmm?
They offered it to you?
No. I had some older cousins and stuff that were doing it.
All right. And they gave you a whole tab or?
No, like 1/8.
1/8.
You know, that, to my opinion, that's child abuse. It really is.
Well, this is her cousin that did this.
Yeah, but,
all right.
Wow.
So 1/8, then what did it do to you?
Well, I just sort of got really paranoid.
Mm-hmm.
I just kind of hid for like the whole night.
Oh, my God.
Right.
What? Oh, sorry. Anyway, yeah,
she,
oh, yeah.
See,
and then,
see what's happened? Just responding to internal stimuli still.
Yeah, no one's in the room.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
All right, you got paranoid, you hid, and then what happened?
I just got really paranoid, and then after that, I came down, and then after that, I had started having flashbacks, like a lot of acid flashbacks, like more than I should, I think.
Yeah. Did you have any kind of a locked-in syndrome where you had trouble coming down?
No, actually,
did
I didn't.
Did you have panic
Drew's
attacks?
Yeah,
out, right?
I did.
Yeah. Anxiety? I'm just thinking about my kids.
See him scratching his head?
What about my kids doing acid?
Are you flashing back right now, dude?
No, I'm thinking about my kids doing acid.
Have you ever taken acid, Drew?
No, thank God.
All right. Yeah. Just checking.
I'd be having a flashback right now.
You pansy!
Are you thinking that your kids might do acid, or
just,
they're doing it right now while you're here?
Yeah. I'm imagining that, and it's flipping.
You got acid laying around the house, Drew?
I'm just imagining it.
Well, it's pharmaceutical grade, but yes.
I think...
It's just masculine, for Christ's sake.
Who are you talking to?
My best friend.
Okay, so what's
the
problem?
So flashbacks. What were the flashbacks? How did you experience them?
I got really panicky. Like all of a sudden, like for instance, let's see.
Panic attacks and depression are common results of the injury to the brain caused by LSD.
Ah, oh, but eighth of a tab. Come on.
To a 9-year-old brain?
Yeah.
I mean, we don't even know. I don't even know what to expect from that.
Eighth of a tab?
Enough to make her paranoid.
Adam just got married. Wait till he has kids.
That's what I'm saying. I'm praying to God it happens soon.
No, but you know, can you just see, like, hey, we had a girl call in one time and never bitching about eighth of a tab. Here, eat this, Adam Jr.
Let me tell you.
I don't believe her.
Adam Jr.
It's going to be a girl. Don't worry.
I don't think there's an Adam Jr. alive. Is
no,
there? You
there
never
will
heard
be
an
no,
Adam
there
Jr.
will not be an Adam Jr.
But no, you know what? There will be.
Oh, no.
Adam
There'll
Jr.
There'll be four Adam. It'll be like, what's his name? It'll be like
George Foreman.
It'll be like Fordham.
No,
Foreman.
Or Bobby Brown.
Like Foreman.
Yeah, but all the Bobby Brown's kids are named Bobby Brown. All the boys and all the girls are named like Bobolina and stuff like that. You know, the blacks are crazy with that stuff. George Foreman's got 30 kids named George Foreman.
That's the best.
Sarah?
Yeah.
The Jews don't go in for that, do they? They're much more dignified. They're much more evolved culture.
I missed you guys.
Oh, I know.
All right. Hey, Sarah.
Yes.
Stop talking to your goofball friend, would you? And if you're going to talk to your goofball friend, don't talk into the phone.
I'm sorry.
All right.
Sarah, listen. So a common injury from LSD to the brain is panic attacks and depressions.
Uh-huh.
That's not flashbacks.
Okay.
That's the result of the injury that occurs when that drug hits the brain.
All right. So what are we going to do now?
Are you having still problems?
Yeah, actually I am. Well, because I took it up until, like, I was 13, so.
How many times did you take it?
Jesus, I don't know.
Oh, my God.
You mean 100 times?
You need to see a psychiatrist. Yeah, somebody who's had experience in dealing with this, because that is a neurotoxin.
Yeah.
And this is serious ass, Sarah. I mean, really, I feel sorry for you that you were in that environment. I was just, imagine some shrapnel hit you or something. I mean, it's the same kind of thing. But there are treatments, and please take advantage of that, because you're now 14, and look, you're trying to negotiate adolescence. It's going to be tough enough. It's tough enough when your brain's functioning normally.
Okay, what's different about doing acid at 9 than at 15?
The brain is developing more quickly. It can interrupt the developmental processes more. We don't know that.
I don't know that.
Yeah, is it like the clay is wetter at 9 than it is at 15? It's almost dry?
It's more like there's more growth underway that
Steven,
can go
bad. Stop drinking those Red Bulls. It's frying your brain.
Dude, you should see yourself right now with, like, your snowboarding version of a yarmulke kind of coiffed up there. But listen to me.
Did you do mushrooms before you got here?
No, I wish. I'm so exhausted right now. I got in late last night.
Yeah, he's punchy.
I'm doing pretzel. Oh, I'm wicked punchy. But listen.
Eat crap.
Just now you should have seen yourself. Like, give me the hat. Give me the hat. I got to show you this. This is my Adam.
It's good radio.
I don't care. As long as I amuse you guys, I don't care. So this was kind of up.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Like that.
Yeah, it pushes it up and gets excited.
Yeah.
This was you, like, trying to contemplate the acid thing. You were like.
Oh.
That was funny. If
you
were
flashback.
Here. I was trying to figure out what your brain would be like at 9. Yeah.
It's growing fast.
That's my thinking look.
One eighth.
When things are growing, it's easy to.
What's the big deal?
Here's the thing about growing biological systems that are growing. It's easy to make things go bad.
Yeah.
Things can go wrong.
All right.
It's like a crowded freeway. Okay.
Right.
And you throw in rocks off a bridge or something.
Right. Right. More potential for trouble.
It's like a crowded freeway.
Oh, shut up.
But you're on.
Steven, I'm just calling Alec. Steven, you gotta, no more Red Bulls for you.
This is only my second one.
But it's affecting you.
Now, Drew, seriously, I need your professional opinion. What's in this stuff?
Ephedrine?
No.
What's in there, Drew?
What's taurine?
Taurine? This is kind of sort of an amino acid. Nothing.
That doesn't hurt you.
No.
That gets you fired up, Drew? You ever drank one
Caffeine.
Of those?
Sucrose.
Niacinamide.
Glucose.
So a lot of niacin to make you feel flushed.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Nothing.
All right. But two of those.
What's I
start feeling it, right?
What's anolistol? What is that?
Anolistol?
Yeah.
Inositol. It's a sugar.
Yeah.
All right. So it's like sugar, caffeine, sugar, and what else? Niacin?
Yeah.
And sugar.
All right. And Drew's wife likes
those. Hey, can I get another
vodka.
One of these Red Bulls in here, please?
No, that's plenty. That's plenty now. No! All right. We're going to take a little break. Stephen Baldwin in here tonight.
Hello.
Celebrity Mole, Wednesday nights, ABC. 10 o'clock. We'll be back after this.
Here it is. Bottom line, it sucks being single today. Tons of lame people and no decent prospects. Call the Dateline. Call the Dateline. Call the Dateline. 1-877-889-DATE. 1-2-3. Love Line. Love Line will be right back. So get your problems ready.
Hey, everybody. It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Stephen Baldwin is our guest tonight. Corey Feldman will be in here, and then D.L. Hughley will be in here, and Jimmy Kimmel's coming in here next week to plug the new show. Always a good time with him. Steven is on Celebrity Mole, which is on this Wednesday. I believe it's the second episode this Wednesday at 10 o'clock on ABC, and looks good by all accounts. Let's get back to the phones.
I have to ask you something. Get in here, please.
He's talking to his,
Wrangler.
Wrangler publicist. Manager.
Yeah. Huh?
Brent?
Huh?
Hey, what's up?
Hey, you're 16. What's up?
Hey, Adam, you're a god amongst men.
Thank you there, brother.
And Dr. Drew, I believe that your knowledge and wisdom has helped countless people. All right. I'm calling because around last Wednesday, I had sex with my girlfriend, and, although the first time was protected, I guess round two, as you would call it, wasn't, and, now here it is.
What's the plan with round two not being protected?
You mean? It was actually out somewhere where I wasn't capable to get a second condom.
Yeah, but did you go rinse your dork off afterwards?
We were actually in a park. So.
Yeah, but you've got sperm all over the place now, and what are you gonna do?
Oh well, I wiped it off my shirt or whatever. But
that's perfect.
Yeah, I know.
I hope. When did this happen?
This happened last Wednesday.
Last Wednesday.
Yes.
Yeah, do that move that the brother man does when he's going for round two. Yep, takes the penis, wipes it under the armpit, and it's right back in.
Look, that should have been the morning after pill outing.
Yeah, well, see, now here it is Monday, and I have an outbreak around the tip of my penis underneath the foreskin, and it's rather irritating. It's rather, you know, it's abnormally red for it being right there, and I wonder what it may be, because she said she got tested last year. And she's only had one sexual partner, which is her boyfriend. And, you know, we're kind of...
Her current boyfriend or her last boyfriend?
Her current boyfriend, actually. We're kind of, you know, I guess timesharing, I guess you would say.
Good times.
But really? She says... Since
is that why you're screwing in the park?
I guess so.
Maybe you got poison oak.
Well, the car is too small, so...
Oh, you're in the car. Oh, you got to go outside the car.
Yeah, of course.
Or maybe you got poison poke.
No, we were on the grass, and
where's the hi-hat, Anderson? Come on now. There you go. Get ready with that. There may be others.
All right, Brent, there is maybe it's just an irritation, which is not uncommon. Are you uncircumcised?
Yes.
All right, so that can happen. And the other thing is herpes. And,
so do you know her boyfriend?
No, I know a lot about him, though.
It's not me dismissing
is that
he's dismissing
No, is that how you say herpes now, Drew? Or it's, you know, it's lifetime luggage.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. And see, I don't know if maybe if her boyfriend was maybe screwing around with her because they've been known to separate for a while and, you know, kind of come
and
back
together. Women can have herpes and not know it rather commonly.
Hey, well, Brent, do you have feelings for her?
I do, actually.
I would imagine as a 16-year-old intelligent boy like Brent is, obviously, having sex with some girl would be difficult.
And not, without not getting feelings.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, Drew, wouldn't you get going? I mean, you'd be nuts. Wanting her to break up with her boyfriend.
Oh, my God. Oh, you'd be parked out in front of her house.
Well, she's a little older, too, so...
How old is she?
She's 19.
Oh.
Yeah.
All the more... Well, she's troubled, but all the more reason for you to become attached to her.
Yes.
Well, see, the only reason why she's really with her other boyfriend is because he's more like financial security, I guess, for her, you know? And it's like right now, I'm currently looking for a job, actually. So I can kind of take off some of that load, but it's like they're not exactly getting along. So I guess I'm more like her, I guess, I don't know how to put it. I guess more like her emotional support and stuff like that.
Hold on a second. Hold on.
Sidebar.
I can't figure it out. We got to discuss Brent over here for a second. He's got a little nerd in him. He's well-spoken. He's obviously an intelligent guy. He's not the kind of guy who gets to bang 19-year-olds when he's in high school.
Not unless he's involved in a bunch of chaos.
Him. Like what kind of chaos? Sure.
That's what I'm thinking. Like maybe.
Nah, he doesn't. I don't get the chaos from him.
Yeah.
What do you mean chaos?
Yeah, get up on your mic, Steven. Come on.
Easy. Be gentle with me, Adam.
All right. I'm sorry.
What do you mean chaos, Drew?
Like being around people that are into alternative lifestyles, all kinds of just a lot of chaos.
He's definitely an intelligent guy, Brent.
Yes.
What's your makeup? Does your family make money?
Yes, we're pretty much well off.
You're well off, and you're a good student?
Yes.
Yes.
It's right. Just,
You wear a monocle?
No.
What about an ascot?
Maybe. I don't know.
All right. You're a smart guy. Your parents have money and you do well.
Yes.
Yes.
Well,
all these things I gathered from you. And I like you, Brent. And you know, I don't like many. I don't like anyone who calls
this
show.
Oh, I know. I've been listening to Loveline for years and the man show and everything. And I get from
Brent, you got any gray poupon?
No, I'm all out, bud. But if I get some, I'll make sure to give you a call.
Rub some of that on your little inflammation there and see what happens.
So. Why is she having sex with you? Are you exceptionally good looking, or is there something wrong with her?
Exceptionally good looking, and I don't. Pretty much, she's a rather normal gal, you know.
You would say you're exceptionally good looking?
I hate to brag, but I've been told that a lot.
Yeah, you're very good looking guy.
Who do you look like?
Nobody in particular. Although back a couple of years ago, people say I look like Tom from Blink 182. So
Tom.
Yeah.
He's the percussionist.
But if Tom wasn't in the in Blink 182, he wouldn't be good looking.
I guess so.
Now, what actor do you resemble?
There's got to be one Baldwin you look like.
I know, out of so many.
Yeah.
I am not really sure, actually.
Come on, somebody.
All right, but chicks are hot for you, right?
Pretty much.
Okay, that's why.
I got to get a visual.
There's something.
Drew, go, baby, go.
The circuits aren't.
I'm picturing Tom connecting. From Blink 182.
Yeah.
I can see Tom.
What, Drew? Yeah. What?
What? How did you even come in contact with a 19-year-old?
Through a friend, actually. We were talking for a while, and
what were you doing? Were you at a friend's house?
No, we were actually on the phone, and she was on three-way, and it just kind of.
How does she know your friend?
They've known each other for years. They're like best of friends.
How old is he?
No, she knows. She. Like,
oh, she.
She's a friend.
15.
Yes.
And a 19-year-old hang out with a 15-year-old
for years.
Well, they've pretty much been best friends since their family is like really close.
All right. They're families. That's fine. It is weird. Okay. Look,
maybe he's special.
Get your penis examined.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I like the cut of your jib, though, son. I'm going to be honest with
you.
And,
all right.
What does that mean?
And this girl's going to get pregnant.
I don't know.
This girl's going to get pregnant. This guy unloads in a condom, pulls off the condom, goes on for number two.
Yeah.
There's sperm everywhere.
Yeah. Sperm
That's crazy.
Everywhere. It's flying everywhere.
What was that?
It's like locusts.
Yeah.
Was that me?
Sperm kiss.
Was that me?
No.
No, that could have been you, but that was...
That was me going...
was
that Muttley Muttley or Stephen Baldwin Muttley?
That was somebody else doing Muttley.
Oh. That's brilliant.
That is a Muttley, though. All right, let's...
Hey, how much longer do we got here?
You
want to go home?
You're coming down. You're crashing pretty hard off
You better get a Red Bull going here.
Sorry.
Steven is sleep deprived. What did you have to do today? You flew out today?
I've been on a motorcycle all day.
Where are you going?
I don't live here, so when I get out here, they run me around.
I'm going to ask the question Adam asked during the break. How did you end up with a motorcycle and not a car? And don't say it because I had a motorcycle.
No, I own a motorcycle that's out here.
But not a car. Okay.
Well, actually, that's not true. I got a Corvette out here, but I don't drive it because it's a 1959 Corvette.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'll probably blow the tranny or something.
You like cars and bikes and all stuff.
Yeah,
like
I'm like a Steve McQueen. Like,
oh, really?
Red Bull.
We got to talk.
Why?
Because I love all that stuff, too.
What cars you got?
Well, I got a bunch of cars.
Yeah, like what now, Pimp Daddy?
I'll get into it during the break.
No, give me one. But not anything too pimpy.
Your Porsche.
I got a 73 Porsche RS. It's cool.
Worked?
Oh, Carrera.
Worked?
Yeah.
Like worked, or just like Hollywood worked?
Worked.
No, it's like almost a race car. It's a great car.
Who built it?
I got it from a guy up in San Luis Obispo. San Luis does
Jag
restorations. It's like $30,000.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, it wasn't that much, but...
What else you got that like... gets down like better than that?
I'm getting a supercharger on my BMW M3. It's gonna have like 500 plus horsepower.
Yeah,
it's not like old muscle car stuff. It's nothing cool. It's more,
you know,
European
what you need?
Stuff.
No,
yeah.
You need, I have a 64.5 Mustang fastback,
mm-hmm.
with a 289 small block.
Mm-hmm.
With a 410 rear end.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this little gal will just mule kick you.
Yeah, that's pretty low rear end. It's a ratio, Drew, for the rear
end. Chicago lock.
Yes. Yeah. You hear about Detroit lockers. You don't hear about Chicago that much. But I don't know what the stock gears are, like 360 or 360 something like that. But anyway, 411 is low. Good acceleration. You don't have the top speed because of the gearing.
Right.
You know, a car could probably only do 125 or something, but it gets to 60 quicker, which is the better way to go, by the way.
Absolutely.
What's into the engine?
289.
I know, but compression, carburation,
cams, stock,
lift, duration, all that stuff.
Stock.
Well, back to the point.
All right. Yeah, I like those fastbacks. I like those 350 GTs a lot. Yeah. What color is it?
It's all white on white.
Yeah, it's nice. Sarah?
Yeah?
You're 15?
Yeah.
What's up?
Once every 3 months when I'm on my menstrual cycle, it's extremely heavy. And when I use, an extra ultra-strength absorbency tampon, whatever, it leaks right through after an hour.
Steven was all day was on his menstrual cycle, driving all over L.A.
Oh, I love when guys PMS.
It's cool, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Drew, what about it?
Well, not uncommon. What are you going to say? That you have heavy periods?
Well, it's just that it started happening after I was under a lot of stress. And then they put me on Nexium because I had ulcers.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if it was like a link between my medicine or just the fact that I was under a lot of stress.
Nexium should not do anything to that.
Or the fact that because I didn't get help for my stress for a month and a half, and I wasn't eating, and my weight fluctuated a lot.
All right, well there you go. That's what's doing this. How much did the weight fluctuate?
It would go anywhere from I actually lost 10 pounds in a week, and then I gained it back.
What do you weigh now?
I weigh 120. I'm set right now. Good right now.
All right, it may be the weight fluctuations that set this all off, and you may be having sort of anovulatory cycles. Have you seen a gynecologist?
No, my friends, I talked to my mom about it, and I've talked to a couple people that have had this problem but don't have stress, and they
said
that their doctor...
Sarah,
Steven's tired now. He's falling apart.
Sarah, you don't know what you have. You have a symptom, and a doctor needs to evaluate to figure out what
I'm
the diagnosis
is. I'm doing semi-4 with Stephen Baldwin. I can't hear the question I'm trying to...
I'm asking him questions, not to interrupt. He's writing me notes. I just flashed, back to a high school classroom.
Nice.
When
get the football, start kicking the football.
You and I were at our desks.
Yeah, playing a little football, looking at triangular football.
Yeah.
Hey, is this information, girls, for here in California for this man? You don't know.
I don't know.
No, Steven's trying to give a plug to
something
that's apropos.
Sunday?
Do not walk around.
All right, forget it.
Do not go out and talk to your friends. And...
Oh, no, it was brought up in conversation.
There is many, many, many reasons for heavy menstrual periods, okay? You need to be evaluated to make sure you don't have ovarian cysts, make sure you don't have infection, make sure that there's not a tumor in your uterus, make sure that there's not some endocrine problem like a thyroid disorder. There's many, many conditions that can cause this. And weight fluctuations may have set it off. I suspect that this is more an issue of your body's normal cycling not being established properly. And yes, being under birth control pill might help this.
All right. She's fine. Good times. Jesse?
Yeah?
You're 15?
Yeah.
Your dad just found out about your boyfriend?
Yeah, okay, well, my parents have been divorced since I was, 5 years old, and then he's always been, the controlling kind of dad, he's always been, never get married and never have kids, he's always been telling me that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I've just, never really told him about my boyfriend. Well, I've been with this boyfriend for, almost a year now. And
you haven't sex with him?
Yes. No, not currently, no.
But last week.
Well, I mean, you've had sex with him, yes?
Yeah.
Unacceptable.
All right.
How old is he again?
My boyfriend?
Mm-hmm.
He's 16.
And your dad found out? Does your dad know you guys have been having sex?
I'm 15 and...
Does your dad know you've been having sex?
Well, yeah, but the time that we did have sex was 3 years ago.
Oh, when you were 12?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I lost my virginity to him when I was, I was 13.
13?
I just turned 13.
And then you stopped having sex with him?
Yeah, because I got in a lot of trouble and ended up having to move away to Alaska.
Because of this guy.
No, not because of him, just because I started sneaking out and stuff and just getting in trouble. My mom finally got tired of it, and she's like, you need to go to Alaska. So I ended up just having to move away. I don't know.
Picked Alaska on the map?
Your mom just threw a dart and a map, and that's where you had to go?
No, my aunt and my uncle live there, and it's my dad's dad.
Okay.
I mean,
well,
my dad's brother, sorry.
Listen, I'd be pissed if the troublemaking, whoring young niece of mine was sent over to squat my frozen farm in Alaska.
North of Alaska?
Whatever, I'm not a whore.
Oh, I'm not, baby, I didn't mean that in a bad way.
Not a literal way.
No, I'm just saying...
She's a ho-ho-ho.
What is this with the kids where you start shifting them around? Like,
yeah, shipping them.
You ship them off to Alaska.
Yeah.
What happened when you got there?
When I got there? Well, I only lived there for like 8 months. And then I started doing really good in school and sports and everything. And then I decided that I wanted to come home. And I've been doing really good since then. You know, I've been back in California for like 8 months now.
So you didn't mess around with anybody there?
No. I was too busy with school and everything. And besides, my uncle there, he was the head of the department of the juvie there.
That's why she went to Alaska.
Right.
I didn't go to juvenile hall or anything, but...
I know, but he can handle folks like
that. That guy's house was juvenile home.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, whenever he came home, he'd always, like, go outside and check footprints in the snow and stuff. And
I think Jess has got another trip to Alaska in our future.
Yeah.
But...
parka.
Yeah.
So, north to Alaska. All right. So now they found out you have a boyfriend.
Well, the reason why it's like so bad is because this last weekend I told him that I was I only see my dad like every other weekend for a couple of hours on Saturdays.
Mm-hmm.
And this last weekend I was with him and he dropped me off at my friend's house because he lives in the same town as my boyfriend.
All right. Listen. I don't got time for this. What's the question? What's going on?
My question is I don't really know how to deal with it because he's not, like, speaking to me now because he just totally flipped out when he
found
out
about it. Your dad did.
Yeah.
All right. You see him once every other weekend, right?
Yeah.
So big deal he's not speaking to you. He's out of your life.
No.
He wasn't speaking to you before
this. Was your dad the reason that you were having sex at 12?
Oh, no.
13.
I just did it because I really wanted to.
Okay.
No, please.
Here's the whole thing.
Who are you talking to?
Oh, she could have been horny at 13.
Oh, for God's sake.
Did an eighth of a tab of acid.
Yeah, there
she
you go.
Got her juices flowing. Look, Jesse, here's the thing. This will blow over.
I think she's going to Alaska.
You may be going to Alaska.
No.
Okay. Okay, you won't go to Alaska. Your dad will cool off. There's nothing you can really do.
She can end the relationship with a boyfriend.
No.
She's 15. Listen, here's the whole deal. When you have, and Steven, you have girls, right? Let me tell you something. I've talked about it many times on this show. You abandon your daughter. You move out on her. They pay you back.
Game on.
You get paid back. Whatever it is you don't want them to do, that's what they do. And mostly what guys don't want their 14, 15, 13-year-old daughters
having
doing is off
drugs.
Having sex and running around with guys and that kind of stuff. Believe me, that's how it'll end up being. I would love to conduct an experiment where guys moved out and abandoned their daughters but said to them, like, I'm never going to see it again, but as God is my witness, I pray that you're with as many guys as often as you can be and as early as possible.
Yeah.
I'm positive, by the way, that they wouldn't be with guys if they knew that was the wish of their abandoning father.
Remember, women are diabolical. They've got to feel that that's really what he meant when he says it.
Right. I don't know what the answer to this is. She's acting out a little bit, acted out in the past.
Yeah,
maybe it's north to Alaska.
Could you imagine being married to Drew?
Mm-mm.
We practically are, Adam. It's fair here.
I know, but...
Listen to what he just said. Remember, women are diabolical. They've got to feel.
He makes a point, though, which is just fooling them with verbiage would not work. They don't listen anyway. They just feel.
What's your wife like?
Like
a former sumo wrestler or something really weird?
No.
Is
she like a petite gal or an Amazon?
No, small.
She kicks his ass, though.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Praise God.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no. She rules the roost over there. Drew's scared S-less of her.
How many kids?
Three. Triplets.
So there's five people in that house, and Drew is number six on the pecking order. There's your wife, there's the two boys, the daughter, you know what, then the maid, then the dog, then Drew.
But Drew's pretty cool, dude.
Drew's fine.
Because he's weird.
Yeah.
And like, well, you know, only a guy like Drew has triplets.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
He was probably impregnating her going, "You're getting sleepy." And like did some Dr. Drew thing.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it like was
that's
one...
what he did.
Implanted five embryos.
Yeah, he did a fertility thing.
But you made
thing.
Something split. And no. Like, you know what I mean? You did something. Don't just sit there like yeah. you didn't.
Be careful, Steve. I will cast a spell on you.
Yeah,
I will.
True.
You'll be up
it's
itching
true.
All night long.
You'll get birth.
I'll kick your ass.
I gotta
birth
say,
to a
I
wagon
gotta say
wheel.
Something. I gotta say something because we're taking another break soon.
Right now.
Wait a second.
Go ahead.
There's a radio program on Sundays in this country by a guy named Dawson McAllister. It's like a spiritual program for kids.
Uh-huh.
And it deals with prayer and all that kind of stuff. So all you little hooligans out there, if you go on your internet and you look for a guy named Dawson McAllister, M-C and then C-A-L-L-I-S-T-E-R, he does a radio program on Sundays and...
That's not him.
Kumbaya. Oh, come on, Steve. Yeah,
something like that. It's something like that.
Well,
so,
now, what kind of spiritual?
It's a Christian radio program.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy is very helpful to really sick young American youth.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to put that out there.
How'd you come on to this guy?
I heard him on the radio.
What kind of steps do you give him?
He gives him the Bible and prayer. And believe it or not, it works.
Yeah. Are you a religious man?
No, I'm a spiritual man.
Right. But this is a form of spirituality.
Absolutely.
All right. And what time? What time's it on?
I don't know. The kids will have to look at Dawson McAllister, M-C, and then however else you spell it, with a C and then an A and then an L-L-I-S-T-E-R.
Well, let's hope it's 10 to midnight when our show's on, Drew.
Mm-hmm. Are you on Sundays?
Yeah, yes. 10 to midnight. But this show will be on earlier in the day, I would imagine.
I would think, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
You know what I realized?
But you're on every day.
Sunday through Thursday. Well, some cities Friday.
You know what I realized when I was driving through the desert a few weeks ago? There's two stations that always come in when you're in the middle of nowhere, religious stations yeah. and Mexican stations. Yeah. Those are the two ones that seem to have the transmitters that cut through the heart of the land. And you know what I was realizing after listening? I like to listen to the religious radio. I find it interesting. I like the characters who are on it. I'll listen to there's like the Bible Answer Man. I mm-hmm. like to listen to that guy. Sort of like it's like a fix-it show, like a yeah. automotive fix-it show, except for it's the Bible. But yeah. here's the thing. Religious guys on the radio, preachers on TV and stuff like that, I realize, scary. They're scary. I yeah. mean, if you're a 9-year-old,
yeah.
most of these guys, you tune in the radio and the
big
guy,
hair and
the guy, the guy's like, and then Job yeah. begat Abraham, and then Abraham begat Ham. And Ham begat Hezekiah. And it's like, if you were 9, you'd be crapping
right.
yourself.
But just like you guys do what you do here with this, mm-hmm. this guy Dawson McAllister does over there.
He doesn't scream at everyone.
No, he's a wonderful guy.
Doesn't do. I drove all the way through through Arizona, and the guy was still on the begats. Job begat Luke. Luke begat. It went on for like 700 miles. It was 900 begats. Eventually, it was like Hobo Kelly. I was waiting for him to shout my name out.
It all started with...
Adam.
Abraham.
Abraham begat
Adam
Hezekiah.
Ham. Adam Ham.
We'll take a little break. Stephen Baldwin here tonight from Celebrity Mole, and we'll be right back.
Love Line. 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Hey, everybody. It's Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew over there. Stephen Baldwin is our guest tonight. Leave him in there. Give him another Red Bull. Stephen is on the computer. He's erratic now.
He's losing it.
Drew was just telling me I was going to get his kid's Hummer. Humvee. Here comes Stephen.
What I did was...
What Steven did.
I tried to, like, hold out in the other room and, like, refuse to come back until I had more Red Bull. Mm-hmm. But they didn't.
You're not gonna be able to go to sleep tonight.
Dude, can I just tell you?
Yeah, mm-hmm. He's tired. He'll sleep.
You're tired?
Not everyone's like you, Adam.
Not really? You don't get strung out? Like, when you get really tired sometimes, you drink a bunch of coffee.
I'm serious. I'm having another Red Bull.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll have three. I'll just snap. I'll go postal.
And you'll be able to go to
bed.
On
Loveline.
You could drink two more Red Bulls and go back to your hotel tonight and go to bed?
No.
No, okay. All right. What kind of motorcycle do you have?
A Katana 750 out here.
Oh.
And then home I got some other stuff.
I like those Katanas.
They're fast, though. You really got to be careful.
Yeah, but they're not those big hogs with the...
Here we go, gentlemen.
All right. All right.
Focus.
I don't like those cruisers. I like that Katana.
What are we doing here?
Hey. Jonathan?
Yes.
You're 20.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
Well, we were trying to, me and a couple buddies are at our apartment right now, and we were throwing around some ideas for our documentary. We're a bunch of film students.
You're gay. Mm-hmm. And?
And what it came down to is we had an idea for documenting a penis tattoo.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen it and heard of it before, but we didn't actually know what the process was and how safe and how you would even do it, really, whether you'd have to have an erection or whether you could even, you know, retain, you know, an erection during a tattooing.
You'll figure it out.
There will be no erection during a tattooing.
I can guarantee
promise
you
that.
That.
Promise yeah. that.
And then what about...
Dude, that's not... You don't know that.
No, yeah.
How do you know that?
We saw a guy get a penis piercing once, and
so?
The penis tried to hide
inside the abdomen. They run away. They go invert.
I have a tattoo on my penis. And I stayed fully erect during the Can I have a Red Bull, please?
He has
I'm kidding.
Hey, Jonathan.
But it says Adam's Deli. Yeah.
But where do you expect to, here's the beef, it says. Where do you expect to show this
film? It says Adam's Deli, 10219 West Cahuenga Boulevard, Los Angeles.
Sorry. Is this just a sort of art film you're planning on creating?
Well, it's a project. It's just a project.
Whose penis?
Sure.
Who's the stunt penis here?
It's actually me.
Oh, good time.
I was going to be the model. We were just trying to figure out, you know, some of the background and how it's done before we, you know, go through.
You're
going
to have to go to a tattoo parlor and ask what they do. I don't know. It's a technical issue.
And then if it works out, you can take your penis to some guy's Cannes. It's all Cannes Film Festival, Joe.
Yeah. Well, we didn't know as far as that, you know, I guess some of the hazards of doing it. Obviously, you know, shoving needles through your penis isn't the safest thing.
Infection in that area, but there's infection whenever you do a tattoo, and potentially, and the obviously virally transmitted disease.
Guys
on their penis, yeah.
Yeah, I think if you're going to do an artsy film on your penis, I would graduate it.
What do you mean?
Like a beaker.
Graduate your penis?
I would put numbers and lines on it.
Yeah.
I would have standard on the right side and metric on the left side.
Yeah.
Well, maybe just a barcode.
Yeah.
Barcode? That's not...
Yeah, that's a statement.
Right?
Yeah, that's a heavy statement.
Right.
Not sure what it's saying, but it's a heavy statement.
I want to know, like, if you wave it over the little thing at the grocery store, what'll happen?
Yeah. Get him another Red Bull. Shannon?
Yeah.
You're 23?
I am, in fact.
What's up?
Well, first of all, before I forget to tell you, Adam, your drug of the century, the one you're looking for to get you awake in the morning for your Stern show?
Mm-hmm.
Called Provigil.
Yeah, Provigil.
Provigil. Yeah. I like that. It's like,
yeah, but it's
like, yes,
we really,
Provigil.
We really don't know the full effects of Provigil. As I said, I had a patient on it. I know. Hang on.
Hold on. I want to hear what she has to say.
I had a patient on it whose blood pressure went completely out of control.
Yeah, this 90-year-old Jew.
No.
That ain't me, brother.
But we really don't know the full.
Lower blood pressure.
There is some. There is some concern that it has, that there's some amphetamine type properties. It's not well understood.
I just thought I'd let you know. Like, well, they came up to me because I have so much sleep cycling. At first they thought I had. The reason I called.
All right. Well, hold on. What does this do for you? This Provigil.
It makes you more alert, theoretically.
Quiet down. I want to hear her.
Literally, I have problems. I can sleep all day.
Right.
Once I'm asleep, it's impossible to get me up.
Right.
What it is it's supposed to be like you take it in the morning, the second you wake up, and it instead of falling back asleep, it's literally like having it's the effect of having eight cups of coffee, but without that jolt.
Right. You don't feel jittery.
Shaky. You don't. Yeah.
Okay.
But you're alert.
You're alert.
Suddenly, it's as if you've been awake for 4 hours.
And that lasts for how long?
And it doesn't last. It wears off by it wears off in two, 3 hours.
Okay.
And good.
Just give me some
regular
of that.
Person, and I'm not
okay.
No special needs, right. But it should be lasting longer or shorter.
All right, I can get
it
some of that.
Pretty well.
Okay.
But I'm not on it anymore. I just because what they did is the reason I called is my doctor diagnosed me with bipolar disorder, bipolar 2.
Yeah.
Rapid cycling.
Yeah.
I think is what it is.
All right.
And the reason I called is because while yes, I do fit. I've read some books about it, and I fit into that category. I do fit into all the descriptions and everything, but there's more. There's something about that doesn't describe it me.
What does she want?
Listen, Shannon, you're not in a position to be making psychiatric diagnoses.
Oh, I fully understand.
Okay, now, you probably also have some sort of what's called access to problems as well, which are called personality disorders. And so while the Axis 1 diagnosis for you, the affect issue, is a bipolarity, there are other things going on that don't fully fit the bipolarity, and that's probably the characterologic issues.
Is it just, I don't know, it seems like I've never had an episode.
You've never been
on... And that's exactly what I was telling my doctor. I've never, I don't feel it's me because it doesn't...
Never been manic.
Everything I read about it is, something happened...
Well, you told your doctor this, and what did he or she say?
And they say that my going up and down must be a cycling, and I'm just a rapid cycling, and I haven't hit a big one. Yeah.
Right. They're trying to predict that it will happen. I mean, in the meantime, you have something called perhaps cyclothymia, which is very similar to bipolarity, and he's sort of expecting that bipolarity is more like what you have than cyclothymia.
All right.
Hey, Drew.
Yeah.
Not just now, but a minute ago, you said a whole thing.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, what was that?
What was that?
The way people look at
I almost
mental
hyperventilated
health.
From even trying to follow it.
Okay, but the way people look at psychiatric diagnoses is, number one, they talk about the mood types of disturbances, the anxiety disorders, that kind of stuff. Axis two are the character constructs, the predominant character issues.
Drew, get the chalkboard out.
Get the book out.
Forget about
the book. Seriously, I want to know.
Yeah.
For my acting.
Okay. And so, for instance.
And why not acting? You're moving behind the camera
now. And what do you need?
You're writing and directing. That pill for?
Oak Vigil for.
I'll tell you why. Because I do this.
Get it? Oak Vigil? Poison oak? Anyway.
Oh, yeah. All right. Yeah. I do. Give him another Red Bull. I do the Howard Stern show sometimes. And I do this show the night before, and I go to bed at 1:30 at night, and I have to get up at 3:30 to do his show all morning. And sometimes
Do you do that?
Once every couple months, and I sometimes.
So you would only need the ProVigil for that instant.
I would need it for that instant. Yes, yeah, and sometimes I do it 2 days in
a
row.
You're just pouring
really
for
hard.
Some drugs from Drew.
I know, and he's not coming through. I got to get that ProVigil.
Hey, what's Fenter mean?
That's speed. It's an appetite suppressant, but it's speed.
Does it suppress your appetite?
Yeah. But
all
speed.
Speed does, right?
Yeah.
But is it good or bad? Is
bad.
It dangerous?
Dangerous.
Why?
Yeah, why?
I remember Fen-Fen.
Yeah.
Right?
Fenteramine, that was the Fen.
Oh, right, really?
But it's not Fen-Fen.
Well, it's not. It's one of the Fens.
Right, so the two of them is what caused all the problems.
No,
the
Fens, it was mostly the Fenteramine.
They're like the guy with the evil twin, the
so
nice
it's,
brother.
So, but seriously, it's bad.
It's not good for you, yeah. It's speed. It's speed.
Could it hurt you?
Speed, clearly, yes.
So is coffee. Could Fentermine
hurt you? No, coffee
hurt
has
you?
An entirely different mechanism. Fentermine can hurt you.
Why? You on it? You on the juice?
No.
All right.
In many, many, many different ways.
I don't believe him. Shannon?
Yeah?
You know the name of those glasses with the stick on them? We're trying to figure out what those old lady glasses, the fat...
Fenter stick.
Yeah, not the binoculars on a stick.
No, the opera glasses on a stick and glasses on a stick are called the same thing. They're called lorgnette.
Oh, my.
Lorgnette?
L-O-R-G-N-E-T-T-E.
L-O-R...
How do you know that? You bipolar little...
The web.
No, I just, my dad's a writer, and I went and asked him.
What's he written? My dad's a writer. George Lucas. No,
Lorgnette. A pair of eyeglasses or opera glasses with a handle.
Yep.
Wow. How do you pronounce that again?
Lorgnette.
Oh,
boy.
Yeah, we're trying to figure that out. Now, this is eyeglasses or opera glasses.
Yep, on it with a handle.
You own a ranch in Ojai.
I was sort of half right with my opera glasses.
Also, lorgnon.
Hmm. All right. It's very, see, I know our demographic, Drew.
Yeah.
They're interested in
they
this
know
kind
everything.
Of information.
Oh, yeah.
Stephen Baldwin is our guest tonight.
Do you own a ranch in Ojai?
That's Alec Baldwin. Stephen's
on... Do you
on,
own a ranch in Ojai?
All right, let's see if, wow. we can, see if that'll sound the same.
Do you own a ranch in Ojai?
Do you own a ranch in Ojai?
Wow. It's like the brothers.
Oh,
it's eerie.
Separated at birth.
All right, that's Alec, and this is Steven, and we'll be back.
Oh, yeah. Everybody now.
Yes, I will be right back.
LoveLine will be right back.
Wow, that's interesting.
It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Stephen Baldwin in the studio. Stephen, we're on the home stretch, buddy. We got about
Hey, can I get... What do I got to do to get a Red Bull around here?
Oh, your Wrangler's gone. That's why you're not getting
them. Your lackey left, Stephen. Now you're screwed.
Trying to get a vein up so he can load up.
Yeah, it's going to tie Dose off up. And shoot up in front of Drew. All right. Stephen is in Celebrity Mole, and that
Which,
is
by the
Wednesday
way,
nights.
I did very well on as a result of my Red Bull consumption.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, did you?
Oh, let me tell you something. My one fear factor, which was stupid, which was brilliant.
Yeah, what do you have to eat on that? Do you have to eat anything weird?
Celebrities don't got to eat.
Oh, that's right.
Hey, what's your name,
but
son?
You got to do stuff.
Son.
Yeah, that's Brian.
Brian, what do I got to do to get her? What am I going to do to get a third Red Bull?
How much is Red Bull paying you, buddy?
I'll get you one for $10.
Fine. Right. I'll bill it to Drew and
listen,
Adam.
You don't want it because the show's on the home stretch.
Doggy, bring me, please, a Red Bull before I go. What was that you think I just read? What was that called? Bipolar bullization?
Hypomanic.
Steven, you're going to go back to W. The staff's going to shoot
Dude, it's like the post-AMA parties. It's perfect.
You're going to go to sleep in a closet-sized room.
You're
going to
be like all jacked on Red Bull, kicking it with Nelly.
I'm telling you, don't want to
come with me?
You don't want that third. You don't want that third. Now, but tell us, though, because I saw the spots. You're jumping off cliffs. You're doing, like, exciting things and all that
kind of
stuff.
For the mole.
Yeah.
No, the mole, let me just, I want to just say this. I did Fear Factor. I won Fear Factor. And Fear Factor was like competing in these things that were, you know, fearful.
Right, I saw it.
And I just killed them.
Yeah, I saw you on that
one. I just killed them in a heartbeat. The last thing was they threw us in a cage and put three keys
underwater.
Together. And then they throw you underwater. And I just kind of like visualized the whole process, grabbed the keys. You know, it was obviously a little wiggy.
Yeah.
28 seconds. Yeah, I came out of that cage, Daddy-O.
Put him in a cage and submerged it.
Oof.
I saw that one.
28 seconds surfaced, swam to a buoy.
Buoy, yeah.
And stomped.
It was impressive.
Now, the mole,
mm-hmm.
You got to do freaky stuff, these activities.
Right.
But there's 8 people doing it, and you're all competing for money that goes into a pot. One person's the mole.
Right.
Trying to sabotage it. So
right.
During the activities, you have to try to watch and remember who did what, where, what they were wearing, what color, what position, who might have done something that was questionable, or right. were they acting, or were they really just a spaz?
And right. the mole, then you get somebody, the mole really tries to do well for a while, too, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, you would think.
But then you get a quiz at the end of the day, and the person with the crappiest score gets executed off the show, and it's a process of elimination.
So right, you don't pick each other to be executed. You get executed if you do poorly on the quiz.
Yes. Mm. So it's like fear factor, but like with like psychology and intellectualness.
And what's the quiz consist of?
Like what kind of questions?
Like during the, you know, watermelon toss, the mole was in what position catching, you know, when you were facing north? It's like whacked.
Really?
But how do you know who the mole was?
You know, yeah.
I don't know.
Don't they say things like, what was Kathy wearing when she, you know, jumped off the cliff?
No, they never say anyone individually or name anyone. They say...
The mole?
They say, like it could be anything totally casual. Like, at breakfast, the mole had what kind of cheese on their scrambled eggs?
So you've got to, at the very beginning, you've got to have a good idea who the mole is.
You have to be watching everyone all the time.
Wow. How'd Frederique look?
She's a lovely young woman who's very healthy as a result of her origin, which is Dutch.
She's a babe.
Dude.
Bouncy, bouncy.
Yeah.
Off the chain.
Yeah.
Is the expression.
Yeah. She's hot.
We had her on the TV show, remember?
Yeah.
Remember Off the Hook?
Yeah.
Off the chain.
Dig that, Frederique. Greatest night of my life is...
Remember her talking about masturbation and orgasms?
You have a ranch in Ohio.
She's a hot woman. Kathy?
I can't do it.
You're 21?
Uh-huh.
You want to know if it's bad, if cum stays under 28-year-old boyfriend's foreskin and they have sex late?
What?
No.
What?
Okay, my boyfriend... is uncircumcised.
Yeah.
And then, so when we have sex at night, and, like, he comes and whatever,
right.
and then we go to sleep, with, you know, and there's cum, like, stays inside overnight.
Of him?
Yes, and so then we wake up and do it again,
yeah.
and I'm wondering if the cum that stays inside is
going
to, like, get bad or something, you know, like,
let me ask this. I've never even been so loaded, and I've been loaded many times, that I've not been able to... waddle to the bathroom after a nice shagging.
And wash off.
And dunk the dork in the sink.
Yes.
And a small pose down in front of the mirror is always necessary.
Post-shagging, dunk the dork. Okay, yeah, got it.
Right. What is it with all our callers that just screw and fall asleep in the position they're in with the penis still inside after the orgasm?
You are creating them.
Is it me?
Why? Because the ones that call and do that smoke weed.
Kathy
does.
Kathy, you smoke some weed.
You got that laugh going.
Is this
going.
A great country or what?
You
no, it wasn't the
no,
laugh.
No,
it wasn't
no.
the laugh. You know what it was? It was this. Let me do the impersonation. It's not smoke weed. Ha ha ha. Yeah. It was smoke weed. Ha ha ha.
No, they go.
Yeah.
No, Stephen must smoke weed. He sounds kind of
no,
like.
No, Kathy, you smoke
weed every day, Kathy.
Who
we know what that is. I know, we just know what that is. We can hear it on people.
So he's just baked and he can't get up and take a leak and towel himself off before he...
Yeah, what's up?
Well, it's one of the things the pot does, it blocks motor initiation.
It's
so
like,
that's why you lie on the floor and you can't get up.
And plus, we're like all worn out. We don't feel like getting up.
Yeah, but you know, I don't like that thing of like you're
blaming the weed.
It's a little sticky. Yeah. I mean, you wake up the next morning, you get up, you're walking out to the kitchen, you're dragging the comforter from your groin. There's dog hair stuck to it and lint, you know?
Yes,
I mean,
nice image. Well, she's concerned that she's going to get an infection because of the old sperm under the foreskin.
She thinks she's going to get pregnant because of the old sperm.
No,
because
they're not using any protection.
Thing, is it, you mean infection or pregnancy?
Yeah, no, I don't care if I get pregnant. No, I'm saying...
Why don't you care if you get pregnant?
Because I want to get pregnant.
You two stoners want to have a kid? Really, Kathy, you're 21 and you smoke a bale of weed every day.
No,
you want to have a kid?
I do not. I'm not a pothead.
pothead like that.
Yeah, you are.
So I smoke a little bit at night before I go to sleep, and that's it.
Well, we hear the effects, okay?
You want to, why do you want to have a kid? You're 21.
I don't know.
Well, you're what? Because you're bored?
You're baked. All right, look. That's, we don't have time.
No, no. I want to know what you do for money.
I don't do anything.
Yeah.
Okay? I live with my mom.
You live with your mom, you don't have a job,
right.
You smoke weed on a daily basis, and you want a kid?
Right, and everyone in America is laughing at me now.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's just sort of white trash stuff. Are you, you're not stupid,
and
right?
And it's not laughing, it's horror. It's like you're gonna damage a kid. You're gonna.
This is what you need in your life right now?
No, I'm not that stupid. If I got pregnant, I would not continue to smoke weed.
Well, what about your boyfriend? What's he do?
The same thing.
Smokes weed.
Smokes weed and hangs out?
We're not just concerned
about that. He doesn't just hang out. He works. He works for this mobile home thing, and he, like, sits up.
All right. Listen, you guys can't have kids. Give it a few years, baby. Get on birth control, would you?
Yeah, you're not going to get any mutant sperm nor infected sperm. Don't worry about that. You're going to get pregnant, though. That's going to happen.
But, okay, so...
Although God knows his
sperm
count.
No, I'm not anyway, because I've already lost one of my tubes.
You lost the tube?
Yeah, that does not prevent you from getting pregnant.
Well, it's like,
you lost it, or you used it to smoke weed out of.
We got to go to break.
You were camping. You forgot the hash pipe. Someone suggested hollowing out an apple. She said, no, use a tube.
Use this fallopian tube.
Hey, dude, don't bogart the fallopian. Does this fallopian have a carb?
Uh-huh.
All right, we'll scrape the fallopian for resins. All right, we'll be back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Stephen Baldwin's going to give one last plug before we sign off. Go ahead, Tim.
Dawson McAllister is a guy who does a radio show. You guys, you kids out there, you got to find him. It's a show that's like about prayer and God, and it's really great. And I know I sound like I'm being silly or something, but I'm serious. And there's an 800 number called 1-800-394-HOPE. Is that right? Hey, I did it right. 1-800-394-HOPE. Look up Dawson McAllister on the web. Tune into his radio show Sunday nights, and y'all will have a good time.
Thank you, Stephen Baldwin.
Thanks, Mole. Drew and Adam.
Wednesday night, 10 o'clock. Good to see you again. And,
see ya.
Come on anytime. And until next time, Sam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Careful, Steve. I will cast a spell on you.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Ingold.
Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.